this a once-in-a-lifetime find, a truly unique piece. It has never been in the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the world of fine antique arms and armor. For those of you who don't know me yet, my name is Lennart Fieban. I'm a specialized dealer for examples of this very, very exciting field of collecting. Unnecessary to mention that whenever I produce a video, there's something important I would like to show to you. But the item I'm going to present to you today belongs actually to the most important pieces I've ever had in my life. It is a once-in-a-lifetime find, a truly unique piece. I'm talking about a medieval helmet, a so-called Cervelier, dating from 1250 to 1350. Now let's have a closer look at the object. The present Cervelier can be dated to 1250 to 1350. It is forged in one piece of metal as a closely fitting skull cap of hemispherical shape. There are 10 circular holes near the lower border that once served to attach a lining and a chin strap respectively. The hole at the front side is of slightly larger diameter, where probably a device was riveted that served to hang in an aventail. More than 27 marks can be observed around the helmet that were highlighted with a red color at a later date, a very interesting feature that we will discuss later in this video. The most dominant feature of this helmet is the large combat impact at the front side, which was probably a lethal one. On the inner face, you can observe several old repairs that show how intensively this helmet must have been used during its lifetime. The old collection label will hopefully one day give an indication to the provenance of this item. When I acquired the Cervelier, it was associated with the present aventail. This is European and dates to the 14th century, a very, very rare item. However, its shape suggests that it once belonged to a different helmet. I thought about the question whether it would make sense to separate both objects. But the surface patina of both the Cervelier and the Aventail suggests that the items have been arranged together since a very, very long period of time. Maybe even centuries. Therefore, it would be a pity to separate these now, and I decided to offer them together. I'm glad that you asked me that. As always, I've spent many hours of research on the question of provenance for the present Cervelier and Aventail. However, without any success, as I already expected. Let me address some general remarks on the question of provenance, because there are many collectors who are insecure in distinguishing originals from forgeries and rely heavily on the question of provenance, which can be completely misleading. Let me tell you why. You have to distinguish primary provenances from secondary ones. A primary provenance would be a helmet, for example, which is sold from the inventory of an armory where you can trace it back to the time of its production. This is indeed an indication for the authenticity of the helmet. A secondary provenance is, for example, a collection being assembled, say in the 19th century, and at some point sold to the general market at auction. This is very interesting because many famous and interesting personalities collected arms and armor in the 19th century. And I personally love to uncover these because This sheds light on the younger history of an item, but these provenances are by no means any indication at all for the question of authenticity. Just because a helmet was sold at auction 100 years ago as an original helmet does not mean that it is indeed original. Then there is a second aspect I would like to point out. There are collectors who assume that every item in the market must have passed through an auction house at some point in the history. This assumption is wrong. There are many pieces that were sold outside of auction houses and it never passed through one of them. So just imagine the present case where the Cervelier and Avantail was kept, as I suppose, in the context of a guild house and for centuries. And somewhere in the history, at some point in the 19th century, the inventory of the guild house is sold off because the guild house is dissolved. Then this might have generally happened on a local base only. So somebody, a collector, a dealer, or maybe just a person who found these items attractive bought that, and subsequently the helmet was passed down from generation to generation in one family. So it appears now in the year 2021 and it is fresh to the market. It is previously unknown to scholarship and nobody has ever taken notice of it. This is very well possible and plausible. And each year some items appear in the market that were previously unknown. This is the third thing I would like to point out. Among some collectors there is this misleading assumption that every important example of arms and armor must have been studied by scholarship within the last 150 years. This is nonsense. Even today, items appear to the market that were previously unknown, simply because aristocratic families, for example, insist on their privacy and don't want their collection or single item they own to be studied and published somewhere. Some of them are also afraid of regulations regarding the cultural heritage, which has become a problem in Germany, and for that reason are not interested in any publicity at all. So, of course, I'm going to continue to try and uncover the provenance of the present Cervelier and Avantail, which I would love to do, but this will in all probability not be successful. And I would like to make clear, this does by no means lower the importance and the value of these objects. Let's have a closer look at the history of the Cervelier, a helmet type introduced in the late 12th century and worn until the early 16th century. Beshwerdin provided an interesting overview about the history of European helmets back in 1920. However, scholarship has gained new insights since then. Still, there's a lot to be figured out. And we should introduce a new branch into this drawing, which describes the development of the Cervelier. Discussing the complete development of this place would be too complex, but I would like to stimulate scholarship looking deeper into this subject. Since there are hardly any comparative pieces of medieval helmets, it is necessary to discuss the early type of the Cervelier on the grounds of pictorial and sculptural evidence predominantly. We will do that in the following. This Italian fresco from the early 14th century in the Hall of Justice of Rocca di Anghera depicts the victory of the Visconti against the Toriani in the Battle of Desio back in 1277. You can observe that the cervelier was sometimes worn as a single headpiece only, without any additional protection for the face or the shoulders. There were also other ways of wearing the cervelier. A carved capital at the Ducal Palace of Venice, dating from 1309, shows in a very realistic manner how the cervelier was used together with a detachable aventail. Its white leather strap shows holes that are passed through by vervelles which extend from the helmet's surface. Through their pierced ends, a leather cord or wire is strung, which firmly fixes both elements to each other. Mail and leather strap are joined by sewing. So, by removing the cord, aventail and helmet could be separated easily. An interesting feature is the cross-shaped hook at the forehead. This corresponds to an eye on the end of an extension of the aventail near the chin. Hanging this into the hook would provide for an additional protection in a combat situation, a feature found on other depictions as well, but not always. Our cervelier shows a hole on the front face which is slightly larger than the others. This suggests that there was a similar device riveted here, allowing for hanging in an aventail. Another highly interesting pictorial source for the equipment of medieval warriors is the so-called Crusader Morgan picture or Maciejowski Bible, dating from circa 1250. There are depictions that show the cervelier worn below a coif. Other images suggest this helmet was also placed either on top of a coif or the mail being attached to the helmet. The latter would possibly have been accomplished as described before, the details being neglected by the illustrators. Last but not least, the cervelier was also worn beneath the great helmet by knights on horseback. Now, why is the present cervelier so special? There are several aspects, but let me begin with some general remarks on the rarity of medieval helmets. Whenever you visit the major museums in the world, you will recognize that there are hardly any medieval helmets on view. Why is this so? The reason is rather simple. Back in medieval times, there was not an antiques market with people collecting helmets for their artistic value. Arms and armor, designed for field use, was considered functional equipment. So, whenever the technology developed further, the older pieces were recycled in order to reuse the costly iron for something else. The very few pieces that have survived the centuries that we can admire today in the museums come from two sources predominantly. Either they got lost in battle and were excavated as ground founds in our days, or in medieval times, people decided to keep a certain helmet because it was related to an important owner and a certain event, like a battle or a tournament the owner fought with this helmet. And one famous example is the Black Prince who is buried in Canterbury Cathedral. His helmet, his crest, his sword, and his shield were arranged in a funeral achievement and have survived until our days in a very, very good condition and preserved very, very well. Let's have a closer look at the comparative pieces of the early type of the cervelier. I know two of them. The first is on view at the Musée de l'Armée in Paris. As you can see on the image, it is a heavily overcleaned ground found. This was common practice back in the 19th and early 20th centuries. Fortunately, today there would be advanced methods in conserving the surface patina. Nevertheless, ground founds usually are not of a very good quality. The second example was exhibited at the Armeria della Rocca. It is particularly interesting because it illustrates how a helmet was adjusted to new developments during its lifetime. Additional plates were riveted to the surveyor in order to change it to an early salad, which must have happened between the years 1350 and 1400. Then there's a third example, which was published in the Zeitschrift Historische Waffenkunde back in the year 1909. I would like to discuss this in the next step. You are absolutely right with your assumption. The present surveyor is not a ground found. It has never been in the earth within the last 700 years, being preserved instead under very favorable conditions. And the question is why? Why did people decide to treasure this particular helmet? An indication for the answer is probably found in the large damage at the front side. At a closer inspection, we recognize that this damage is probably the result of a massive combat impact, leading to a deadly wound for the warrior who fought with this surveyor. So, this helmet must have been kept by persons who had a strong relationship to this fighter, being either defenders who took this from an enemy as a war booty, or maybe also a comrade in arms died wearing this helmet and it was treasured in honor of him. Approaching this idea, let's have a closer look at the lower border of the helmet again. You can observe more than 27 marks stamped around it, highlighted with a red color at a later date. What was the function of these? Normally you would expect an armorer's mark and a guild mark, if any at all. An interesting thesis can be found in an article published back in 1909 in the Zeitschrift für Historische Waffenkunde. The author presents a surveyor from his own collection, which is of slightly later date, the 15th century, but strikingly similar regarding the lethal combat impact and the high numbers of marks stamped around it. He suggests that the surveyor was taken as a war booty during an attack on the city walls by the members of a metalworking guild. Afterwards, it would have been stored in the guild house, each member signing this helm with his personal mark. As a comparative case, he refers to the city of Torn in Poland, where back in 1909, when he wrote this article, the Butcher's Guild still preserved a half armor from the 16th century and a coat of mail in their guild house. Both items were verifiably taken as a war booty centuries ago. To me, this seems a very plausible explanation. Back in medieval times, the defense of a city was organized by the guilds. Each guild was responsible for a certain area in the city, and their members were obliged to buy arms and armor on their own expense, their personal equipment, and perform military service during an attack. Maybe one day the identification of one or more marks on these helmets will shed light on this highly interesting thesis. Besides being stored in a guild house, as indicated earlier, it seems also very plausible that the present surveyor formed part of a funeral achievement in a church or in a chapel. I could imagine that the marks, which are stamped around the helmet, were personal signs of comrades in arms who would like to honor the fellow who died in combat wearing the surveyor.